Okay, so good afternoon. We'll get going with the school program. Sort of an odd time to be starting on a Sunday afternoon, but since we all had a day off yesterday, hope everybody's back suitably energized. The first two lectures will be by David Reguera on classical theories of nucleation. Now, unlike the conference program, all the lectures for the coming week are going to be pedagogical in nature, which means that ideally every slide before the speaker goes on to the next one is clear to you. And if it is not, you should interrupt. Feel free to interrupt. If that gets out of hand, it'll be the duty of the chairman to moderate it, so don't worry about it. If anything's clear, keep asking. And I also request David and all the other lecturers to sort of pause roughly once in 20, 25 minutes to solicit any clarifications, okay? So, I hope it's important, well, it's important that whatever is during the lectures during the school are all only impressionistically clear, but they're really clear. So let's all work towards that. So, David.
Thanks everybody for coming, and it's a pleasure for me to start this series of lectures on the school on nucleation, aggregation, and growth. And we will be starting by discussing just the basic underlying ideas of what is known as classical theory of nucleation. Okay, so probably this lecture should have come before the actual conference, because we have already heard a lot of different examples of nucleation phenomena. You have already seen many times what is nucleation rate. You have heard concepts like critical cluster sizes. All of these concepts are coming basically from these classical theories of nucleation, and my goal in this series of lectures is that you learn or at least understand the basic ideas that are behind these theories. Okay, so I'm going to try, as re-requested, to give the lectures as pedagogical and simple as possible. So I apologize for the speakers of the conference and the other lecturers, which probably will get bored by these lectures, but hopefully the students will get at least some grasp of what's going on here. And as Reed said, please interrupt me at any time. If you have any doubts, I will try to clarify whatever you need, okay? So basically, here is the outline for these lectures. First of all, I will try to make a very general introduction of what is nucleation, why it's important, and all these basic ideas before starting to discuss the group of all works that many people has been done, especially in the 20s and 30s of the last century, in trying to understand how phase transitions take place. This group of ideas is known as classical nucleation theory, and it was originally derived to study the condensation of a supersaturated vapor. So I will focus a lot on this example because it's probably the most pedagogical and the most simple one. And basically, nucleation can be split into two parts. It's essentially a kinetic problem. So you want to know at which speed the clusters that are the embryos of the new phase form in a supersaturated or a metastable phase. So we will start by discussing the kinetics of nucleation. But eventually, you will see that just kinetically, you cannot solve easily this problem. So you have to resort to some thermodynamic ideas in order to go a little bit further and be able to make some predictions about nucleation rates. So I will be mostly focusing on condensation, but I will also discuss later on how nucleation theory applies to other examples of phase transitions, in particular to bubble nucleation and cavitation, to nucleation in condensed phases, so the formation of crystals from solutions or crystals from melts. Also, to discuss this idea of heterogeneous nucleation, so most of the stuff I will be discussing will be regarding homogeneous nucleation, which is conceptually nicer and simpler, But in reality, most nucleation phenomena take place heterogeneously on the top of surface or defects. So I will discuss these ideas of heterogeneous nucleation. And to end these lectures, I will discuss how good are this classical nucleation theory in comparison with experiments and simulation. I will stress once more the limitations of classical nucleation theory, the assumptions that are made, and the limitations that they have. And finally, if I have time, I will give a quick tour of recent developments in theory in order to solve these limitations and these conceptual problems of classical nucleation theory. Okay? So I guess there are no questions for this slide. That's a good one. Okay. So what is nucleation? Essentially, nucleation is important because it's the first step that controls how phase transitions take place. Okay? So we are all familiar with the fact that the matter can come in different states. For instance, here we have a nice picture representing the three different states of water. We have vapor water in the atmosphere, we have liquid water in the sea, and we have water in a crystalline or solid state in the form of ice. So what is the state of water in each particular case are the relevant thermodynamic parameters. So basically pressure, temperature, density. And the way to represent what is the most favorable state for water at a given conditions is in terms of this phase diagram. So this is the phase diagram of water, where you have here what is the pressure in atmospheres, this is the temperature, and the different colors represents different states of water. So we have solid water at low temperatures, we have vapor water at high temperatures and low pressures, and in between we have the liquid phase. Okay? So these are the three different states of water, and of course we are all familiar with the fact that, for instance, at atmospheric pressure, water crystallizes or freezes at around 0 degrees Celsius, and it gets into a vapor phase at around 100 Celsius. And this process of going from one phase to another phase is called phase transition. Okay? And it gets different names depending on where you go. So for instance, if you go from the liquid to the solid phase, you get freezing. If you go from the solid to the liquid, you get melting. And for the liquid gas transition, you have evaporation or vaporization if you go from the liquid to the vapor phase, or condensation the other way around. Okay, so the idea is that if you have water at atmospheric pressure and temperatures which are higher than 100 degrees, you got the gas phase. And in principle, if you lower the temperature of this gas phase and get it below 100 degrees, you should go to the liquid state. Okay, that's the static equilibrium thermodynamic picture. But the things are not as simple as that. And the fact is that you can have liquid water at temperatures below 0 Kelvin, or you can have vapor at temperatures below 100 Kelvin. These states are called, for instance, supercooled liquid, when you have the liquid at temperatures in which the stable phase should be the solid, or supersaturated vapor if you have a vapor at a set of conditions that it should be liquid. And these phases are not real equilibrium thermodynamic phases, are just metastable states of this substance, of water in particular. And they are metastable because in order to phase transformate water from the liquid to the solid state, you have to pay some energetic cost. So you can keep water in the liquid state below 0 Kelvin because you get into a metastable state and you have to overcome some energetic price in order to complete the first transformation and go from the liquid into the solid state. Okay? Let me show you a video showing that. You will see a bottle of water which is below 0 Kelvin and is completely in the liquid state, and you can keep it like that forever. So this is liquid state, but then you bump it into a surface and then it immediately starts to crystallize. Okay? So you will see another way of getting that. So you have water below zero. It's in a metastable state. It can be there forever unless you perturb it. You give it some energy to overcome this metastability, and it crystallizes and goes into its thermodynamically stable phase, which is the crystal in this case. So the same happens not only for crystallization, but also for condensation. If you have a vapor and you supersaturate it, you put it at a temperature below its equilibrium temperature of, or a pressure higher than its equilibrium pressure, you eventually will form liquid drops out of it. And nucleation is the mechanism that tries to explain how this process takes place in reality, microscopically, and at which speed, and which conditions, and what are the parameters that control this phase transition, how you go from one state, thermodynamically stable, to another state. Okay, so far, we are good, I guess. Okay, so besides this classical example of vapor getting into a liquid, or liquid water getting into ice, nucleation is also the mechanism that is behind many, many phase transitions. Essentially, most of first-order phase transitions. For instance, another example is this bubble nucleation, so the formation of liquid, of vapor-like bubbles in a stretched liquid or in a superheated liquid, which is an example which has not only you know, an academic interest, but it also has some practical consequences. For instance, the speed at which boats can travel is somehow limited by the cavitation of bubbles. So you have here an image of a propeller of a boat which has been practically destroyed by the formation of these bubbles, by the cavitation of these bubbles. So when the boat, when this propeller starts to rotate, it gets velocity, the velocity decreases the pressure can be strongly negative, and then you have this bubble formation, this bubble form collapses, and the energy that they release during the collapse, it's able to etch this very strong material. So being able to predict and to control cavitation in a water system has also a lot of implications, a lot of practical implications. Another example where nucleation is very important is in atmospheric science. So basically, the precipitation, this nice rain of the monsoon, is controlled by the condensation of water molecules in the atmosphere. Also, there is a lot of interest in understanding the condensation of water molecules on what is called atmospheric aerosols, because these control the reflectance of energy from the atmosphere to the space, and they play a very important role in trying to understand this heap of climate change. So nucleation is very important in atmospheric science. We have seen already in this conference examples where nucleation is also important in the context of biology. So the formation of protein crystals occurs because of a nucleation process. There are many diseases like Alzheimer's, and we heard a very nice talk the other day about the formation of these amyloid fibers that involve some kind of nucleation process. I will mention later, if I have time, how nucleation is also important to understand the self-assembly of viruses. And, you know, you have examples of nucleation at all scales. Even the formation of earthquakes also responds to one of these nucleation phenomena, the formation of planets, galaxies. There are many, many examples where nucleation is really important, and that's the reason why it has been studied for several and several years. Okay. Yeah. Well, actually for all phase orders, phase transitions, because the essential ingredient of this nucleation is overcoming a barrier. And you always have a barrier when you have a phase transition which is first order. If it's second order, in some cases you don't have such a barrier and the transition can occur in a different way, like I will explain you in a moment.
Regarding this atmospheric example,
well, you have many difficulties. One of them regards the how many aerosols you have in the atmosphere. This pretty much can be measured, and there are very good measurements of that. The second problem is how these aerosols induce the nucleation, the condensation of water vapor, because eventually the size of the aerosol is controlled by how many water molecules it can uptake. And eventually, the reflectivity of these aerosols is controlled by their size. So you have to understand everything all together in order to be able to make predictions. And so far, there is no way we understand quantitatively, you know, the importance of aerosol condensation in the atmosphere, and that make huge error bars in most of the predictions regarding climate change in this particular context. Mm-hmm. Okay, more questions at this point? So far, the basic idea is we have phase transitions between the different phases of matter, and they are controlled by the existence of some barrier which will try to explain its origin, which makes that you can keep systems in a metastable state, and that you have to pay some energetic cost in order to switch from one state into another state. Okay? Okay. I've discussed many examples in different contexts of nucleation, but I will focus in most of the lectures in one of the simplest examples of nucleation, which is the condensation of a supersaturated vapor. Okay? So how you go from an homogeneous vapor into a liquid phase, and how the first embryos of the liquid first form in a metastable vapor. And in order to get a little bit more idea of that, let's focus on the simplest van der Waals fluid. So here we have one of the isotherms of the van der Waals fluid. So this is the pressure, this is the volume, and this is the isotherm. Okay? So this isotherm describes both the liquid state, which will lie here, and the vapor state, which will lie here. Okay? So you have this artificial kind of loop in between, and actually what you know is that this van der Waals loop describes the coexistence between the vapor phase and the liquid phase. And in order to have these coexistence conditions for a given temperature like here, what you have to do is this Maxwell construction. Okay, so basically impose that the pressures and the chemical potentials of the two phases are equal, and you get these 2 points. These 2 points describe, at this particular temperature, the coexistence between the vapor phase and the liquid phase. And you can do that at different temperatures. Draw different van der Waals isotherms, get this Maxwell construction, and get a collection of all points at different temperatures which describe the coexistence between the vapor and the liquid phase. And this collection of points is this line here that is known as binodal. Describes coexistence between vapor and liquid phase. Okay? There are another couple of remarkable points in this van der Waals isotherm, which are the maxima and minima. Okay? There is one criteria of thermodynamic stability which says that the compressibility of a phase cannot be negative. So in these regions here, between this maximum and this minima, this requirement of positive compressibility is violated, and this region here describes an unstable fluid in this case. Okay? So the collection of these maxima and minima at different temperatures describes the second line that I have plotted here, which is known as spinodal. Okay? Inside this spinodal line, the fluid phase is metastable and is unstable, and between the binodal and the spinodal, you have a metastable fluid. Okay? And the way you can go from a vapor phase into a liquid phase, the mechanism of phase transition depends on how you manage to get your system into this phase diagram. So if you take your system and you increase the pressure and put it in a supersaturated state and you lie into this red region where the vapor is metastable, the mechanism in which it will phase transform is nucleation, and is controlled by the existence of this barrier that implies an energetic price in go from the homogeneous vapor to the liquid state. Okay? So basically the microscopic mechanism will be the following. You have your homogeneous vapor, you will have thermal fluctuations that will eventually generate these liquid-like droplets, and these liquid-like droplets are the ones that will lead all the phase transition. Okay? So this is nucleation. The second mechanism of phase transition that you may have is called spinodal decomposition, and it will occur whenever you manage to get into this green region, into the region where the fluid phase is unstable, it's mechanically unstable. Okay? And this second mechanism, it's very different, and it's characterized by the fact that there is no energetic barrier to overcome in going from one phase to the other. So the transition in this case will occur spontaneously. So here I have an example of a system which is decomposing by spinal decomposition. Okay? So it's a separation of a mixture, and you will see that it doesn't go through this formation of spontaneous little droplets that they grow and decay and eventually control the whole phase. The system is instantaneously, in this case, decomposing. Every point is starting to decompose, and you have this kind of characteristic wavy shapes when you have a spinal decomposition. So this mechanism is very different from nucleation, and I will focus mainly on nucleation and not on spinal decomposition. In many systems, it's very complicated to phase transform via spinal decomposition. Like, for instance, for the condensation of a vapor, it's very hard to reach these conditions in which the vapor is unstable, because eventually, as you get deep and deep into this metastable phase, nucleation will take place, and that will decompose your system before you reach spinal decomposition. Okay? Yeah, but at least for a vapor, unless you do it in a simulation where you can do an instantaneous quench, in reality, whatever expansion you do is slower than eventually the time it takes to make this nucleus, and your system will phase transform by nucleation and not by spinal decomposition. So only in systems which are whose dynamics is relatively slow, you can get into a spinal decomposition regime. Yeah, at least in a critical quench you can do it. Okay, so what are the important... I will focus on nucleation, and what are the important concepts in nucleation? Basically, for vapors, one is supersaturation. This supersaturation is the parameter that controls how deep you are into this metastable region. So essentially, for a vapor, supersaturation is defined as the pressure in which this vapor is divided by the equilibrium vapor pressure, which will be for this isotherm, this point here, the coexistence point, okay? So as you enter more and more into this metastable region, the supersaturation is higher, and eventually what you expect is that the nucleation barrier will be infinite at the binodal and will get progressively into zero when you reach the spinodal line. Okay, the other important concept is this nucleation barrier, is the height of the energy barrier you have to surmount in order to be able to proceed with this phase transition. The critical cluster size, so is this particular size that corresponds to the maximum of the energy formation of a cluster, and is the minimum size of a cluster that you have to build up by thermal fluctuations in order for the phase transition to succeed. And of course, the most important concept is the nucleation rate, is the rate at which these critically sized clusters form in the system as per unit volume and per unit time. Okay, so these are the concepts that will be involved in this classical nucleation theory. Okay, the difference between nucleation and spinal decomposition. So basically, the main difference is the degree of, the process of nucleation occurs in metastable phases. As I showed you before in the movie with the supercooled water, you can keep this supercool water forever, because even though at temperatures below zero the stable phase is the ice, the system cannot spontaneously phase transformate into that, because you need some energy, to start the phase transition and to build the first crystals in your new phase. Okay, so whenever you need this energy and you have to overcome some energetic price, you are in this process of nucleation, and it's characteristic of this region here, where the system is metastable but is not fully unstable. Okay, so the other process, the system is completely unstable. It means that you start. Imagine this example of the water. You can supercool it even more. You can put it eventually into minus 100 Celsius. At these conditions, well, not for water, is not a good example because it will get glassy. But if you supercool it even more, this barrier that opposes the phase transition between one state and another gets lower, lower, and lower, and eventually it will vanish, which will correspond to this situation. And that will mean that every molecule in your liquid phase will start to make a cluster of the new phase, and the system eventually completely decomposes into the new phase, without any kind of metastability. Mm-hmm.
New question. In this plot, this G versus N plot, so is it possible to associate this with the example that you showed earlier of that of the new, condensation of the supercooled water?
Yeah, so
can you plot, which point is it possible to look at?
So the video you show will correspond to this red region. The water was metastable, so it needed some kind of energy in order to crystallize. And the energy was provided by this kick that the guy was doing into the system. Okay? Eventually, if the water will be at lower temperatures, it will decompose immediately. So you cannot keep it into that state. For water, is more complicated because eventually you get it into a glassy phase. But for a vapor, it will be like that. For a vapor, if you put it into this region here, if you pressurize it much more, eventually you cannot keep it metastable at any time. It will immediately go into the liquid phase. And this is the process of spinodal decomposition. So the main difference is the presence or absence of a barrier to make this phase transition. This is real. Well, this is a van der Waals fluid, but it also holds for any fluid.
No, so is there like a bigger picture example, like you gave us clouds and fibrils or something, where this happens in surveys? As in, like, a big example in nature, like clouds or something like that. How do you see an actual difference?
As I mentioned before, for instance, for clouds, spinodal doesn't play any role because you cannot reach these conditions in practice.
So do you ever reach it in nature?
Yeah, this is an example of a decomposition of a binary mixture. There are many examples of systems that can decompose via this spinodal decomposition mechanism. Okay? So it's not that it's just theoretical, but, you know, let me focus mainly on nucleation, which is, in most practical cases, the one that occurs all the time. Okay? Yeah.
The size of the critical.
You will show later what are the expressions for the height of the nucleation barrier and the critical nucleus size, and eventually both follow the same tendency. As you get deeper and deeper into the metastable region, the barrier height goes down, the critical cluster size goes down, and eventually this spinodal will correspond to the situation in which every molecule in your system is a nucleus of the new phase. And that's the reason why it occurs in such a complete and coherent way. Okay?
What is binodal decomposition? Binodal decomposition.
Spinodal decomposition.
Binodal.
No, the binodal line is this line that represents the coexistence, the state, you know, the pressure and volumes that corresponds to the coexistence, in this case, between a vapor and the liquid phase. Okay? If you have water at equilibrium, you have liquid water, but you also have a small portion of vapor water. Okay, so when they are at equilibrium, the pressure that you have in the liquid water and the pressure that you will have in the vapor phase, when they coexist, this is this equilibrium pressure that I mentioned here. And what is the value of this pressure for different temperatures is what describes this binodal line. Mm-hmm. So it's the pressure at which vapor will coexist happily with liquid at some given conditions. This is what is called the binodal.
So does it have any barrier also? Barrier. Does it have any barrier?
So at the binodal, in this picture of nucleation, the barrier to decompose one system into the other will be infinite. So you have the two systems coexisting, but in the absence of impurities or whatever, you cannot go from one to the other. You have to pay an energetic cost. Okay? So let's move on a little bit and keep on discussing this example of condensation. And as I mentioned before, the idea of this condensation is how, if you have a supersaturated vapor, if you have a vapor which is in this metastable region, how it phase transforms into the liquid phase. So microscopically, the idea is that you have these vapor molecules which are continuously dancing because of thermal fluctuations, And these thermal fluctuations will generate small aggregates of molecules which start to look like a liquid phase. So they will generate some clusters of molecules which start to have the properties of the liquid phase. Okay? So the formation of these little clusters, when they are very small, it's energetically unfavorable. So these small clusters will tend to redissolve back into individual molecules. But when these clusters get into a very large size, they eventually are thermodynamically favorable, and these are the ones that will form the new phase. Okay? So what is important here is to know what is the cost in energy that it takes for each clusters to form, depending on their size.
You had the delta G shown there, which is delta U minus T delta S for a given temperature.
Mm-hmm.
So when you are telling the cluster size, your entropy is decreasing because, I mean, can we think in terms of this particular equation, the barrier height, the cluster, because when the particles are accumulating, the energy is increasing.
Yes, so you have a competition between
the
energy...
Yeah.
Because these molecules at the microscopic scale, they have some interactions and they want to stick to each other. And you have entropy, which favors that the molecules are in the vapor phase, just happily exploring the whole thing. But actually, the barrier can be expressed in simpler terms with this work of cluster formation. So you may think that the cost of forming these clusters has two contributions. Okay, one, which is favorable, which is just associated to the chemical potential. When you are in a supersaturated conditions, the chemical potential of the liquid phase is smaller than the chemical potential of the vapor phase, and this is the thermodynamic driving force for the transition. So you have some advantage in making these clusters of M molecules, which is just the difference in chemical potential between the two phases times the number of molecules. Okay? So this is what you gain. But if you want to make this cluster, you also have to pay some price, and this energetic price is related to the surface tension. So you will have this liquid-like cluster surrounded by vapor-like molecules, and there is an interface between these two. It costs you some energy, and this is the price you have to pay. So eventually, if you sum up these two contributions, you will end up that the free energy formation of cluster as a function of how many molecules it has this kind of funny shape, where you see a barrier, and the height of this barrier is the nucleation barrier, and the location of this maximum is the critical cluster size. This picture means that if you make a cluster with a number of molecules which is less than the critical cluster size, this cluster is energetically unfavorable, and it will try to slide down this barrier, so it will redissolve back into the vapor phase. But if you manage to make a cluster which is larger in size than this critical cluster size, it will energetically go down, so it will keep on adding molecules, it will keep on growing, and this is what will be the embryo of your new phase, the nucleus of the new phase, and that is what is called nucleation mechanism. Okay? So this is qualitatively the picture. We will get more precise in a moment.
David, I just wanted to complete that course. Because you had told that supersaturation matters.
Uh-huh.
When you are going towards the deeper and deeper supersaturation near the spinodal,
what changes is this the chemical potential difference. So in a moment, we will see what is the relation between this difference in chemical potential and the supersaturation. Okay? Okay, so another thing that one has to have clear is that there are two possible mechanisms of nucleation. One is homogeneous nucleation, this spontaneous formation of clusters in the bulk of your vapor phase. But you can also have heterogeneous nucleation. You can have this process occurring on top of a surface, on top of some dust particles, on top of impurities, whatever. This heterogeneous nucleation mechanism, we will later see that is always energetically more favorable. So in most practical circumstances, the phase transitions occur due to heterogeneous nucleation rather than to homogeneous one. But if you manage to have a very pure substance with no walls, no impurities, homogeneous nucleation will be what happens. Okay? Okay, so as I mentioned, the way this supersaturated vapor converts into a liquid phase is by the formation of these little clusters. And what is important for to know what is the speed at which the system will phase transformate is to evaluate what is the rate of formation of these critically sized clusters. Okay? So the basic idea of nucleation theory and the starting point is that it tries to describe what happens with this cluster. What is the kinetic of formation of these little clusters containing N molecules? Okay, so let's start to discuss what are the underlying ideas in the kinetics of nucleation. Okay, so the basic assumption is that these clusters, in this case containing I molecules, these are the number of molecules in this cluster, they can grow and decay in number of molecules by the addition or loss of individual molecules. Okay, so you can think of this process as a sort of chemical series of chemical reactions where you have this cluster of size I, and it gets one molecule and gets into a cluster of size I plus 1, or a cluster of I plus 1 molecules which loses a molecule and gets into a cluster of size I. Okay? So the basic assumptions in describing nucleation in this way is that you are assuming that the clusters grow and decay only by the addition of individual molecules. So you are not considering cases in which two molecules get into the cluster or this cluster loses two or three molecules. This is a pretty good assumption unless you are really, really close to the critical point or at very high densities, because the number of monomers, the number of isolated molecules that you have is much, much larger than the number of dimers, trimers of any other composition. Okay? The second assumption in the basis of nucleation theory is that there is no memory, so that when one of these molecules collides with this cluster and forms part of it, when the next one comes, it has completely forgotten about what happened before. So there is no correlation between the addition or loss of one molecule and the next one. And the third big assumption is that you are doing everything at isothermal conditions. So temperature is constant and it doesn't change. Of course, this is just an assumption because when you are condensing one molecule into the system, there is always some release of heat. But you can also treat classical nucleation theory in non-isothermal conditions, and you can show that this approximation, in most cases, it's okay. Okay, so with these assumptions, the basic equation is the equation that describes... It can be, of course, two or three or four, but you can calculate what is the probability, you know, what is the relative probability that one molecule collides into the cluster versus the probability that two molecules collide at the same time into the cluster, and it's much, much lower. Okay? So, of course, the addition of two molecules, if they don't happen at the same time, can be considered as the addition of this one molecule followed by the addition of a second one. Okay.
Yeah, we can make a time scale smaller than this. I mean, in one molecule by one molecule, as you are telling, is it like that? I mean, two molecule, is that the assumption? Is
so
like
it's not like, it has to be two molecules which are together. So it has to be a little dimer, okay? Or a trimer. Okay. And you can calculate what is the probability that in an homogeneous vapor you have dimers, trimers, or individual molecules, and it's exponentially decaying. So in a regular vapor, the number of monomers that you have, it's several orders of magnitude larger than the number of dimers or trimers. So that's why this approximation, it's very good in practically all cases.
So I guess, David, you did say that this was a good assumption only for small degrees of metastability, right? If you're looking at extreme super saturation,
so you really have to be at very dense conditions, so very high super saturations, or close to the critical point where everything it's also like that, in order to have this. So essentially, what you need is that the number of dimers in your system is pretty much equal to the number of monomers or trimers for this to fail. Okay, and this occurs in these conditions.
So, I mean, even if you relax this condition. Right. In principle, you can sort of write a set of equations.
Yeah, you can relax this condition and write the corresponding master equation, taking into account collisions by dimer, trimers, and so on.
Right.
But it's
how much more complicated?
It's much more complicated. and eventually at the end you see that the contribution for these terms is completely negligible in most circumstances. So that's why everybody forgets about that. And there have been some simulations showing that the occurrence of addition of dimers or trimers in a simulation is completely negligible compared to this mechanism. So this mechanism works pretty well unless you really are at the very, very, very deep supersaturations.
You started with this assumption that the nucleation is the first step of phase transition. Now you assume that you are very much closer to the critical point. So what's the width of the phase transition? How do you know that you are very much, very close to your critical point and it's also a first step of your phase transition?
So it's not that, you know, what I will be discussing will be in principle valid in any place of this thing. So this is the critical point. So I will discuss in how nucleation happens.
No, my question is, how do you predict the width of the phase transition that you that will tell that you are in a liquid state, now you are in a solid? For example, what's the width of the phase transition?
Here,
can you predict that?
In principle, if you know the full equation of a state, you will be able to predict where the binodal is. That's relatively simple. Where the spinodal is much more complicated. Okay, but in some...
I mean that if you do some quantum phase transition, then there is a... Always you can predict the width. I mean, you can say that you just started your phase transition, that the liquid is starting to behaving like solid. So when you are saying that you are in very much... That means first we assume that there is a first step. Nucleation is the first step of the phase transition. That means there are several steps are there. Yeah, that I know.
This is a first order phase transition. Mm-hmm. So, and nucleation, what tries to explain is when you start to go from one phase to the other. So, in this region here, in principle, the stable phase is the liquid. But it doesn't mean that you have a liquid here. Actually, until you start to make this nucleus, you won't have the phase transition. And if by width you mean under which conditions you have one phase or the other, this is delimited by this region. So the binodal gives you the first set of conditions at which the new phase can form, and the spinodal tells you that for sure, if you are in this regime, your new phase will be the other one. So in between this width of this region, it tells you, you know, the width of the region in which you can have either of the two phases. Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I have another naive question. Is it possible if you are at very high concentrations that instead of monomer addition or dimer addition, is it possible for growth to occur by two clusters, as in if you have several nuclei being formed? That's not true. The nucleation is a very rare event, or it's possible, but...
It's usually a rare event, but it depends on the degree of metastability. If you are very close to the spinodal, all clusters are...
Can also coalesce as such. I mean, that can happen.
You will have all these sort of problems. But usually the height of this nucleation barrier is very large.
Okay.
And you will see in a moment. The probability of having clusters of a particular size is controlled by the exponential of this work of formation. So when the barrier is very high, the probability of having a cluster of size 2 is exponentially smaller than the probability of having a cluster of size 1, and so on. And this formation of these clusters is a very rare event, and that's the reason why you can keep phases metastable, because the spontaneous formation of this nucleus of the new phase is a rare event, so you can keep it for long times until this thing happens.
Excuse me? So... You are discussing the example of condensation of vapor to liquid. But if you consider the example of liquid to solid...
I will treat it later.
But
the idea are the same. You will have some fluctuations. In this case, it won't form a liquid-like thing. It will start to form a phase in which you see the same order as in the crystal. So you will have some molecules showing crystalline order. And the same will happen. There is an energetic cost to form that, and in that case is related to the surface tension between the crystal and the liquid. And when they are small, they tend to dissolve back into the liquid phase. When they reach a particularly large size, the system will completely crystallize. Mm-hmm. The ideas are the same.
Example.
Yeah, I will discuss how it goes for bubble nucleation and for crystal nucleation later on.
Excuse me. I'm a little bit confused regarding what is a first order transition and a second order transition.
So it's characterized by the discontinuity of some thermodynamic potential. And for my thing, the important thing of a first over the phase transition is that you have some latent heat. And you have some discontinuity, in this case, between the density of the liquid and the density of the vapor. So you go from one phase to another, which have very completely different thermodynamic properties. Mm-hmm. In a second order phase transition, there is no latent heat. The discontinuities are in the second derivatives of the relevant thermodynamic potential.
Mm-hmm. So it means if we take a path of going to supercritical liquid and going to supercritical fluid and
yeah, in that case you will have second order phase transition. So I'm just below the critical point discussing first order phase transition, like the usual ones.
Oh, thanks.
Mm-hmm. In you know, in these simple systems.
Yeah. So David, sorry. It may be useful to just draw the Landau free energy, since you had one already for the first order transition, maybe also for a second order transition.
Well, you mean?
Yeah.
You mean this is kind of the Landau picture for the first order phase transition. This will be kind of the Landau picture for a second order phase transition, actually. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Let's keep on the kinetics. So what we want to know is what is the rate of formation of these clusters, and the equation described this evolution in cluster size is this, what is known as the master equation. Okay, so in this equation, what you try to describe is how many clusters. This f of it is just the concentration of clusters having I molecules at a particular time t. It's the number of clusters per unit volume that has this total number of molecules, okay? And what you want to know is how this number changes with time. And this, the number of clusters having I molecules can change in this picture because, you know, you can have another cluster of size I because a cluster of size I minus 1 got one molecule. So this is the term giving you clusters of size I minus 1 getting one molecule, getting into clusters of size I. You can also have the process in which a cluster of size I plus 1 loses one molecule and gets into a cluster of size I. Okay, so you have these two positive terms. A cluster smaller that gets one molecule, a cluster larger that loses one molecule. But you can also have a couple of terms that describes that a cluster of size I either loses one molecule or gains one molecule. So you will lose clusters of this size because they evaporate or get one molecule more. Okay, so these are the possibilities taking into account that you just consider the addition or loss of one molecule. Okay, so in this equation, this alpha of it is the rate at which individual molecules will detach from a cluster of size I, and this beta of it is the rate at which individual molecules will attach to a cluster of size I. Okay, so what we do with that? So you can write that in terms of what is called the current. You can try to get what is the average current of clusters of size I going to size I plus 1 or vice versa. So basically, you get that this change in the number of clusters of size I with respect to time, you can read it as a difference between these two currents. The current of clusters going from I to I plus 1 and the current of clusters going to I minus 1 to I. So you can rewrite this expression with this definition into this very simple form. And this J is just the current. It's the how many clusters grow from one size to another size. And this is the quantity that we want to estimate. So in particular, this quantity is time dependent, but what is of interest in nucleation is what is known as the steady state nucleation rate, which corresponds to a situation in which the number of clusters of a particular size doesn't change with time. So you impose that this derivative is zero, and that gives you the steady state nucleation rate. Okay? And it's constant, and what is important is that it does not depend on time, so that is what is called a steady state. It also does not depend on the size. So what you will have is that clusters just keep on changing size in a continuous way, the same for all cluster sizes. This is the quantity of utmost interest in nucleation, this nucleation rate.
Go through that again once.
Okay, so basically we have this master equation. It takes into account all these possibilities. So cluster gaining or losing one molecule. So you can rewrite this. You see that this equation has a very funny and particular shape, and it's composed of these two terms. So you can write it, if you collect this term and this term, you can call it the rate of clusters going from I to I plus 1. So basically, if you draw an interface in between, this will be I plus 1 half. Mm-hmm. The number of clusters, the rate of clusters crossing this interface will be given by this. Essentially, it's clusters of size I plus 1 that lose one molecule and go to I. This is this term here. And the other term is clusters of size I that get into I plus 1, which is this term here. And the idea is that you can rewrite the equation on top just by the difference between this current for this particular size and this current for a size I minus 1. Okay?
So are you going to say something about the rates, alpha and beta later on?
Yeah. Okay, actually in the next slide.
Counter clusters of different sizes with a certain steady state probability, right?
Yeah. So
with a certain constant probability once it's reached.
Yeah, once you impose these conditions, it means that you are imposing also what is the steady state distribution of clusters. Because this will be the distribution of clusters that guarantees that the next, you know, that it doesn't change with time, so it's a steady state, and it guarantees that the flux is just constant. Okay?
I guess, so there may be something that's confusing here, because once the critical nucleus forms, the system will transform to the new phase, right? So, but one, maybe you can say a couple of words about an experimental setup that you can have where you maintain a steady state population even while nucleation takes place.
So basically, whenever the barrier is relatively high, you will quickly get into these steady state conditions, because the formation of this critical cluster size is unlikely. So basically, everything will stabilize on one size of the barrier. Let me go back. So basically, in a normal experiment, if you take a vapor, you lower the temperature, you quench it, you will get this barrier to make a liquid phase. So essentially, this barrier is preventing, it's forcing this steady state condition. So very quickly, you will get a distribution of clusters, which will be the exponential of this size of the barrier. Nothing will have happened here, and you reach these steady state conditions. And in these steady state conditions, the clusters will eventually form. And what you are trying to describe is how the formation of these clusters occurs at this condition. So in right. most practical circumstances, you are a steady state at the beginning.
No, but I think the confusion can be that if you're going to be talking about a steady state rate of forming the critical nucleus, mm-hmm. but I know that once the critical nucleus is formed, the system is going to transform to the new state. So how do I maintain the steady state?
So it's just that what you are concerned in nucleation is the rate of formation of the first clusters, which controls how long can you keep the phase metastable. After the formation of these clusters will keep on growing and will keep on depleting the vapor phase. But eventually, this is a different process, which is growth. So nucleation focuses on essentially what is the first cluster that forms in the system, and that's the reason why steady-state conditions are okay to describe nucleation. If you want to describe nucleation and growth, if you want to describe the whole fate of the phase transition, of course, steady-state conditions are not good enough. So this is just for the first part of it.
Sorry, I just have one question again. So as I know it from biology, the difference between equilibrium and steady state is that in steady state, you're using energy to actively maintain the equilibrium.
In a steady state, Well, here you don't need some energy, so but it's not equilibrium. The distribution of clusters is not the equilibrium one. You have to impose some boundary conditions, let's say, to keep this steady state. Mm-hmm. And I will show you the boundary conditions later on.
So there is no energy is being expended to keep it at this state. I'm sorry, I'm a little confused because...
So you will see this steady state is essentially an approximation to calculate things. Things will not occur in a steady state, but if you plot... Let me show you, see if I manage. Two, okay. Okay. So basically, what will happen in an experiment is something like this. If you plot what is...
So David, can I just make a clarification? Just in terms of... Who's asking the question? No, there is no steady state that's being maintained by pumping in energy or any such thing, right? So at most, what you could have is a situation where, for example, you're forming these clusters, but let's say they're being taken out of the system because of sedimentation, and there are new molecules coming in through some bath that you have. So it could be a steady state in that order, in that sense, but no steady state that's maintained actively by pumping in energy.
Yeah, there is no artificial steady state, okay?
Before that, it reaches the nucleation barrier, the barrier height, I mean, before, it is unstable, right? I mean,
yeah. All clusters in here are unstable.
Yeah, so that region... Then as the cluster increases in size, it's become unstable, I mean, more unstable. It will tend to go back to its original state.
So that's what keeps the phase metastable. So you start to make one cluster.
Then how can we reach steady state, actually? That's what I'm asking, actually.
No, because, all these fluctuations, they form these clusters, but eventually... It will take a long time to make one that crosses through the barrier.
But once it crosses the boundary, nuclei is formed. Then it's steady, I can understand. But
before that, what happens is that these fluctuations try to make it over the barrier. They cannot do it. And eventually what you have is a steady state concentration of clusters. It's not the same cluster which is in a fixed number of molecules, but collectively all of them will have the same distribution of clusters, and this distribution doesn't change with time. Essentially, this distribution is somehow similar to the exponential of this barrier here.
That's
and
right.
It's the same. And you can have it for long, long times. That's why you consider them steady-state distribution. Okay?
Okay.
So then in steady-state, do we have clusters with size less than n-star?
Yeah, so basically you have clusters of size less than n-star, but... the bigger the size, the less probable are these clusters. The less number of clusters you have of big sizes. Okay? But overall, if you plot what is the distribution of clusters versus size, you will have that it's time independent and it's always the same. This is the steady state distribution of clusters. Mm-hmm. Of this trouble. Okay? So basically, you have this equation for the... Is it ready? Okay. So you have this equation for the distribution of clusters. So if you will know what is the rate of attachment and the rate of detachment of clusters, you can solve all this set of equations and you will solve the problem. Okay? The problem is that you don't know one of these constants. Okay? This steady state nucleation rate essentially is given by this. It's the rate of attachment of molecules of size I, and this is this f of I, which doesn't have the time. This is the steady state cluster distribution. So if you know alpha and beta, you will be able to estimate the steady state distribution and the steady state rate. But the problem is, okay, beta, you can have it from kinetic theory. This rate of attachment of individual molecules to a cluster of a given size can be obtained in a very good approximation just by estimated in an ideal gas what is the frequency of collision between individual molecules and an object of size A, of a cross-sectional area A. So you have this expression coming from kinetic theory, and it's very good. Actually, it has been tested in simulation. It gives you a very good hint of how fast individual molecules collide and attach with a cluster of a particular size. So half of the problem, you know what it is and you have it solved. The problem is that the evaporation rate, the rate at which individual molecules go out of a particular cluster, there is no theory for that. There is no simple theory to evaluate evaporation rates. So you cannot solve this problem because you don't know what is the evaporation rate of a particular system. Okay? So kinetically, you are stuck here. You know half of it, but you don't know how to proceed. And the way to proceed is to avoid this problem of not knowing alpha is to resort to what is known as the constraint equilibrium hypothesis. Okay? What is this constraint equilibrium hypothesis? Basically, what you imagine is that you may have a distribution of clusters which is not the steady state one, it's the equilibrium one. Okay? So essentially, this equilibrium distribution of clusters is the one that satisfies that there is no net flux of currents in size. So there is no clusters growing from one size to another size. The distribution of clusters is the same for all sizes.
Sorry, David. The statement you made about alpha.
Uh-huh.
If I imagine that I have a liquid droplet, why is it so hard that I calculate what the evaporation rate is?
You will see that some of the modifications and improvements on classical nucleation theory goes precisely in that direction. But there is no simple expression of evaporation, you know, because at the difference, the other one is kinetic. You have molecules flying by, you can calculate the cross-section of collisions. This is relatively simple. The other one is that you have a collection of molecules, yeah, and one of them suddenly pops out.
Yeah, no, I mean, I can assume a Maxwell distribution of velocities of the molecules at the surface of the liquid droplet.
But you have to know the potential.
Surface tension, yeah. But assuming a number for the surface tension, I can calculate.
Yeah, but it's a very bad calculation, actually, and you get a result which will be horrible. But actually, most of the modifications and improvement of CNT go in that direction. If you evaluate directly alpha, you don't need thermodynamics. You can solve the problem kinetically. But it's very difficult indeed. And many of the things you may think of for getting alpha are actually thermodynamical. You may have what is the evaporation rate and related to the latent heat, but it's essentially using thermodynamics eventually.
Mm-hmm. You need to know something about the diesel energy of the molecule cluster. That becomes system specific, right?
It becomes very specific on the potential, so I don't think I will have time to get into that, but some of the new ideas for nucleation go in this direction, in trying to evaluate the rate of evaporation of individual molecules out of a cluster directly for a particular system. The problem is that this depends very sensitive on the intermolecular potential. And the problem is, if you solve the problem just using alpha, the nucleation rate is extremely sensitive on an accurate evaluation of alpha, because eventually the nucleation rate is just the product of all alphas for all cluster sizes. So if you make a mistake of a 1% in the evaluation of alpha and your critical cluster size is 100, eventually you have an inaccuracy of a 100% in the nucleation rate. So these ways of getting alpha are so sensitive that in many practical circumstances is not the best way of getting the rate. It's very inaccurate. But of course, it's one of the ways to go.
Yeah. No, sorry. The reason I raise this question is, when you're talking about liquid nucleation, you have a nice way of calculating the beta because you treat the gas as an ideal gas. But if you look, depending on what transformation you're looking at, like if you're looking at liquid to crystal, it's not so obvious how you calculate beta either.
But there are some approximations, and I will show you also. You can relate that, in that case, not to the rate of collisions of molecule to a cluster, but to the frequency of vibrations of your molecules and how they diffuse in your liquid phase. So you can always make a sensible guess for the addition coefficient of molecules to a cluster. It's always much harder to get the guess in the other direction. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the idea to overcome that problem is to resort to this equilibrium distribution of clusters. So as I mentioned before, the work of formation of a cluster of a particular size depends on some energy of formation, which later on I will calculate it more explicitly. And the idea is that the equilibrium distribution of clusters that you will have in a system will be given basically by the Boltzmann factor involving this free energy of formation. So the number of clusters of a particular size that you will have in your sample is controlled by the exponential of the free energy that I need to spend in order to form them into the system. Okay? So this equilibrium distribution of clusters is just the probability, you know, this exponential factor is just the probability of having a cluster of a particular size I, and is very approximately given by the number of clusters. If I have a sample, I have it at equilibrium, I sample the clusters that I have in the system, I count how many clusters I have of a particular size I, and divide by the total number of clusters. That will give me the probability of observing a cluster of a given size, and this probability will depend exponentially on this free energy of formation. Okay?
A is a function of small n, right?
Sorry, I cannot hear you.
This, oh, n is the number of particles, small n.
Where? Yeah, oh, sorry, here, yeah. Sorry, it should be I. It's the number of molecules in one of these clusters. Mm-hmm. So this rate of attachment depends on the number of molecules because the area, the cross-section for these collections depends on how big it is. Sorry, I use sometimes I and N indistinguishably. It's number of molecules in one of these clusters.
David, when you have a cluster of size I, then the J of I is zero. Means no particle is coming in, no particle is coming out. What do you mean by the constraint equilibrium?
Constraint equilibrium means that, you know, that will be the equilibrium distributions of clusters that you have in the system, but you will never have this distribution in reality because you have to constrain the system somehow to prevent these large clusters to falling apart. Okay, so that's the work of formation of a cluster of a particular size, but these clusters are not stable. So in order to have them form in the system, you have to put some constraint. And actually, this constraint is the basic idea of one of the main simulation techniques to study nucleation, which is Monte Carlo umbrella sampling. You are constraining your clusters to have a particular size, and I guess tomorrow we will listen more about that. And it's called constraint equilibrium distribution because it's a distribution that you will never see in a real system, although it's the hypothetical equilibrium one. Mm-hmm. Okay. So why I use this equilibrium distribution, which means that the number of clusters I have of a particular size will depend approximately on the total number of molecules I have, exponential of the work that I have to invest to make a cluster of a particular size. And the idea is that if instead of imposing a steady state condition, I impose equilibrium conditions, if I impose that the current is zero, that there is no net flux of clusters going in one or another direction, if I put here zero and I substitute this steady state distribution by the equilibrium distribution, you will have this. And this constitutes a relation between the evaporation coefficient and the condensation coefficient in terms of the equilibrium distribution. So you now have a relation that tells you how much, what is the value of this evaporation coefficient that we cannot easily guess in terms of the condensation coefficient that we know, and this ratio of equilibrium plus cluster populations, which it's related to this free energy formation of the cluster. So basically, we have converted this kinetic problem into a thermodynamic problem of evaluating what is the free energy formation of these clusters. Okay. So we now have an expression for alpha, and I can substitute in this current, I can substitute this alpha by this alpha here, and you have an expression for the current. This is the steady state nucleation current, which depends on the ratio between the steady state probability and the equilibrium probability. These are two different probabilities. Okay? So how we get the rate out of that? Essentially, if you have this, what you can do is to sum overall cluster sizes. So you pass this down, you sum overall cluster sizes from cluster size 1 to a particularly large cluster size, which is on the other side of the nucleation barrier, and which is very unlikely to be seen in your system. Okay? So if you sum overall cluster sizes, what you will have is the sum of these terms, which one is one molecule more than the other. So you will have F1 divided by N1 minus F2 divided by N2. And coming from here, you will have the same with a negative signs, and so on. And essentially, what you have is the sum and the subtraction of the same terms. And what it remains is only the first one and the last one. So you will have that the rate and this sum depends on the ratio between the steady state probability of clusters of size 1, individual monomers, and this ratio corresponding to very big clusters. Okay? So here is where you impose these boundary conditions that will keep you a steady state. And the boundary conditions that you impose is that the distribution of monomers is equal to the equilibrium distribution. So you are constraining the system so that in your steady state, the number of monomers is the same as you will have in an equilibrium system. Of course, this is just an approximation, and when nucleation happens with a high rate, this is not a very good approximation, but still. And the second condition is that clusters which are much, much larger than the critical cluster size are very unlikely, and you won't see them in your simulation eventually. So these are the boundary conditions that you impose to solve this equation, and essentially what it means is a way of keeping this steady state by just removing clusters of size which are very big and putting these molecules back into the individual molecules. That's the way you keep this steady state mathematically. It's nothing you do experimentally in your system. It's just a mathematical construction to get the rate. Okay? So then, this is 1. This is 0. Essentially, you get this sum equal to 1. And from here, since the current is constant, you can take it out and express this thing in that way. And essentially, you see that now the steady-state nucleation rate only depends on the rate of condensation of molecules and this steady-state distribution. So if you know what is the free energy of formation of a cluster, you can put it here, you can calculate the nucleation rate, you have solved the problem. Mm-hmm. So let me show you how you get it eventually. So this is the expression for the steady-state nucleation rate. Okay. And in order to make a solution out of that, what you typically do is just make a continuous approximation. So you have this sum over all clusters from cluster size 1 to IB, and you replace this sum by an integral. Right? So you replace the sum by an integral, and the next step that you do is that this integral depends on something which is an exponential and which is highly peaked around the critical cluster size. Okay, so if you have an integral of something which is an exponential and have such a peak, basically what you do is what is called the steepest descent approximation. So you evaluate this integral around the maximum, which will give you the highest contribution to this integral. Okay, so you expand the free energy of cluster formation around this maximum, and you will have that the free energy of formation of a cluster of a particular size is the one of the critical size. The first derivative is 0. Okay, because this is the maximum, and then the first correction is the second derivative in here. So if you make this substitution into here, essentially you have a Gaussian integral, and you can calculate very easily this integral, and you get to the final equation for the steady-state nucleation rate, which is the important thing. The derivation is not so much interested in something you can follow. The important result is the final one. This is the rate, the steady-state rate of formation of clusters of the critical size, and it depends on basically 4 factors. One is N1, is the number of individual molecules that you have in the system. The more molecules you have per unit volume, the higher will be the nucleation rate. The second factor is this rate of attachment of molecules to a cluster of critical size. Okay, so the rate of cluster formation depends on how fast individual molecules will collide with a cluster of critical size. The third thing is this C, which is called the Seldovich factor. It's just the result of this integral. When you make this Gaussian integral around the top, it gives you this correction. which is essentially a correction coming from the local curvature on the top of the barrier. So this is the second derivative of the free energy formation around the top of the barrier, and this is just this correction. Essentially, it's physically connected to the probability of recrossing. So if you have a cluster of critical size and it grows a little bit, it still has some chances of getting back, and this Seldovich factor corrects from these recrossing probabilities. Okay. And finally, the most important factor is that the nucleation rate depends exponentially on the free energy of cluster formation, of formation of this critical cluster size. Okay. So what you see is that the rate of formation of these clusters can be split into two terms. One is purely kinetic, which is this one, is the rate of formation of clusters, how fast molecules collide with these clusters. The other one is thermodynamic, is this free energy of formation of a cluster as a function of how many molecules it has. This Seldovich factor, mathematically, it comes from this integral. When you make this approximation around the top, this exponential here will give you a Gaussian term. When you evaluate this Gaussian, you will get this correction. This is mathematically. Physically, what it means, you can show that this Seldovich factor is connected to the distance in size in which the change in the height of the barrier between the top and whatever points is just 1 kT. It's connected to the local curvature on the top of the barrier. The second derivative gives you the curvature on the top of the barrier. And what it's giving you physically is the probability that one molecule that just made it beyond the critical cluster size can go back and recross on the other direction. In transition state theory, which for some of you may be more familiar, this will be like the recrossing factor. Mm-hmm.
We assume that in a system there will be one cluster which becomes a critical cluster and it grows. It was in the constraint, I mean, because you have a system, you have shown here that there will be one critical cluster, or one cluster which grows to a critical cluster. And it's not that you can have many clusters. And
no, this is giving you the number of, the rate of formation of critically sized clusters per unit volume and unit time. So it accounts for many clusters. If you have more molecules, you may have more critical clusters. Okay, so it's not accounting just for one. It's accounting how many you have per unit volume, per unit time. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is the main result that I wanted to get in this derivation, is the rate of formation of critical cluster sizes has two terms. One is kinetic, one is thermodynamic. Okay, and actually, probably tomorrow, Charusita will discuss one method of simulating nucleation, which is based on this splitting of this problem into getting the barrier height and getting the prefactor, the kinetic prefactor. Mm-hmm. The most important thing is that the exponential sensitivity of nucleation rates in barrier height makes that the, what is really important is to get a good evaluation of what is this height of this nucleation barrier, because the changes, you cannot do it too bad in the prefactor. So what you have to make it right is this free energy of formation. Okay, so since many of you are probably more familiar with another kind of equations, I will show you just quickly that the master equation I showed you at the very beginning can be replaced by a continuous equation of the Fokker-Planck type. Okay, so this is the master equation that I showed you at the beginning. So this is the change in the number of clusters of a particular size as a function of time that can be written as this, as the difference between current of clusters going past size I and current of clusters going low size I. So if you see, this is like a difference. So if you approximate a derivative by just discrete difference, you can write this like that. So it's minus the derivative of a current with respect to size, making this continuous approximation. The other expression we saw is that the current was given by this, which also involves this difference between f of I of t divided by n and f of I plus 1 of t divided by n. So you can approximate also that by another derivative, and if you put everything together, what you have is that the change in the concentration of clusters of a particular size with time can be expressed into this kind of equation, which is known as a Fokker-Planck equation for nucleation. Why I put this equation? I put this equation because this nucleation process is what is known as an activated process. Every time you have a process in which you have to jump over a barrier, this is called an activated process. And one characteristic activated process is, for instance, a chemical reaction. So there is a well-known theory to describe chemical reactions, which is Cramer's theory, and essentially it's the same as this. You want to know what is the rate of your reaction, in this case is going from a small cluster to a big cluster, and the equation describing Cramer's theory in the high friction regime is essentially the same conceptually to this equation for this. So you can use the same techniques to solve this, and you will end up with the same result. The steady state rate of crossing this barrier or forming this critical cluster sizes is given by this expression, and in other contexts is not called nucleation rate, sometimes it's called Cramer's rate, other people call it transition state rate, some people call it Arrhenius rate, it's all the same. It's the rate at which you are crossing a barrier. In this case, the physical meaning of the barrier is the free energy of formation of clusters of a particularly big size. Okay? And this Fokker-Planck equation was also the basis of many of the things I discussed in the talk during the conference. So you can calculate mean first passage times out of that. You can do many nice things with this continuous approximation, which is just the same as the master equation in a continuous way. Okay? Okay. So basically, that ends up the first part about the kinetics. So nucleation rate is to get what is the rate of formation of these clusters, and we have now expressed this problem basically into getting what is the free energy formation of a cluster of a particular size, which is the critical cluster size. So now we have gone from a kinetic problem into a thermodynamic problem. We want to know what is the free energy formation of these clusters, and for that we use thermodynamics, and this is what we are going to do now. Probably quick, because we don't have much time. Okay, so the second main idea of classical nucleation theory is to use thermodynamics to estimate what is the free energy of formation of a cluster of a particular size. And we will be doing it following Abraham's book. It's one of the references I put in the abstract. Well, this is just very basic thermodynamics. You are probably all familiar with that, so I will not discuss it too much. The idea is that you have some internal energy which depends on some relevant variables, the entropy, the volume, and the number of particles. At equilibrium, variations of this internal energy must be zero, and you have another complementary equation, which is the Gibbs-Duhem equation, which these couple of equations you can do many things, but of course the internal energy is not always the potential you want to use. In order to get to other potential, this is the free energy, which Gibbs free energy, which depends on pressure, temperature, and number of particles. You just make a Legendre transformation of this internal energy, and you have also variations of this free energy. So depending on the thermodynamic parameters that you control, whether there is entropy, volume, and number of particles, or pressure, temperature, and number of particles, you have to use one thermodynamic potential or other. Normally, for nucleation, the most important potentials are these two, because experimentally what you control is the pressure and the temperature, not typically the volume. You control pressures, temperatures, number of particles, or chemical potentials, volumes, and temperatures. So these are the two most important. Okay, so in order to calculate the work of formation of a cluster of a particular size using thermodynamics, you have to do several approximations, and these are the drastic assumptions that classical nucleation theory makes. The most drastic one, probably, is that you are assuming that you can apply thermodynamics down to describe clusters which are molecular in nature, clusters which only have 10, 20, 50 molecules, which are really, really small. This is definitely not a thermodynamic system, is something very small, but you are assuming that you can still apply thermodynamics to describe that. The other assumption drastic that you make is that we are going to consider that the two phases that are involved in this cluster, you have a liquid phase and a vapor phase, when you have one of these clusters, the in this liquid-like droplet, the properties are homogeneous all the way up to the surface. So you have the same density as in a liquid, and the same properties as in a liquid. So basically what you are doing is that if you have a drop, which physically it will be, if you plot the density profile, so what is the density from the radial direction onwards as a function of the radius, you will have something which is smooth. Thermodynamically, you are assuming that this drop is, it has the density of the liquid all the way up to the interface and the density of the vapor outside, and the distinction between these two is sharp. Okay, this is what is known the capillarity approximation. You are assuming that the interface that separates this small drop from the vapor is absolutely sharp. Okay, another very drastic approximation. What else? You assume that all the properties of this cluster are the same as in a bulk liquid. So surface tension is the same as in a macroscopic liquid. Density will be the same as in a macroscopic liquid. Equilibrium vapor pressure is the same as in a macroscopic liquid. Okay? And we are extrapolating that to describe clusters which are tiny, just a few molecules. And another three assumptions that can be easily released, and actually CNT does not rely completely on that, but assuming that simplifies all the calculations, is that the clusters are spherical, so your molecular cluster can be replaced by just a spherical piece of your bulk liquid, that the vapor surrounding it is completely ideal, and that the liquid of this drop is incompressible. So you, it has the same density no matter how much pressure you have outside. These are simplified assumptions, but you can do it without assuming that. Okay. So then how you calculate this free energy formation of a cluster? So basically the picture that you will have thermodynamically will be like this. You have a vapor phase, you have your drop, which will be the liquid phase. Separating the two, you have some kind of interface phase. So the thermodynamic properties for the whole system will be additive. So in the total number of particles in your system will be the number of vapor molecules plus the number of liquid molecules plus the number of molecules in the surface in each of these three separated phases. And the internal energy will be the same, the sum of vapor plus liquid plus interface. Okay? And what are these interfaces quantities? Basically are defined as excess. So the internal energy of the interface is just the difference between the total energy of your system and that of the vapor and the liquid. Okay? And the same for the number of particles, the same for all the properties. So this interface phase is defined as the excess of what is left from taking the total energies from the energies of vapor plus liquid. Okay, so then you can write what is the internal energy for each of your phases. So this is for the vapor, this is for the liquid, this is for the interface. And the extra assumption that you make is that the interface has no volume. So it's basically you can replace it by an area. It has an area, but has no volume. So it's just the internal energy is temperature times entropy plus chemical potential times number of molecules, surface times surface area. This gamma here is the surface area, okay, which is the intensive parameter related to this area of this cluster. Okay, so let's keep on going, and probably in view of the time I will skip that because I don't need it. The goal now is to use this thermodynamic to calculate what is the free energy of formation of a cluster of an arbitrary size, right? Of a cluster containing an arbitrary number of molecules. So let me skip this one because we don't need it. Essentially, in this slide, what I wanted to do is to calculate what is the equilibrium conditions between a cluster and the vapor phase. And the equation describing this equilibrium is known as the Laplace equation. Okay? But I don't need that to get the free energy formation. The second one, I also don't need it, is the generalized Kelvin equation. It gives you what is the size of the critical cluster in terms of supersaturation, but I can also skip that. Okay? And let's go directly to how you calculate the work of cluster formation in your system. Okay, so the work of formation of a liquid drop in your system is given by the difference between the free energy of a system containing vapor plus the liquid drop minus the free energy of the system being in an homogeneous vapor state. Okay? So this free energy of cluster formation depends on the thermodynamic variables that you are controlling. In particular, it depends whether you control the total number of particles, the pressure and the temperature, or the volume, the number of particles and the temperature. It will give you different results. So it's very important to know which are the variables that you are controlling in your sample. That will give you different values. Okay, so I won't enter into the details, but basically, using all the equations I showed you before, so the internal energy for each of the phases, getting the Gibbs free energy, and doing it right, this is an exercise that you can do. You can get what is the free energy of formation of a cluster of a particular size, and it depends of the difference in pressure between the vapor and the liquid phase times the volume of your liquid drop. This is the contribution of the surface, so surface tension times the area of this drop. This is the chemical potential difference between the liquid drop, between the liquid and the vapor, times the number of molecules of the liquid. And you also have another term, which is the difference in chemical potential between your interface and the vapor, times the number of molecules at the interface. Okay? This is typically something you want to get rid of. And in order to do that, what you do is to define your interface in a smart way. And this smart way is called the equimolar definition of the interface. So what you do, as I mentioned before, the drastic approximation you do in classical nucleation theory in this version of thermodynamics is that you replace a density profile of a cluster which is naturally smooth by something which is sharp, and what you choose is the location of this dividing interface, where the interface lies. So there is one way of defining this interface, which is known as equimolar, and the idea of this equimolar definition of the interface is that is the one that makes that the number of molecules in the surface phase is zero. So essentially, you choose this interface so that the excess of molecules you have in this part and the excess of molecules you have in the other part are essentially the same. So this is the definition of the equimolar. And with this definition, you get what is the free energy of formation of a cluster, which is given by this expression. And it has this familiar structure of difference of chemical potential between the liquid and the vapor times the number of molecules. This is the contribution of the surface. And this is a small correction related to the PV work. So if you want to make a cluster in a vapor, you have to spend some work in making room from this cluster. And this is the kind of work you have to spend to make it. So this is the general expression of what is the free energy of formation of a cluster as a function of how many molecules it has. Okay? So, in particular, if you consider that this liquid drop is incompressible, the difference of chemical potentials is given just by the difference in pressure, and you end up having this very simple expression for the free energy of formation as a function of cluster size, which is qualitatively the same as the one I showed you before. This is the surface tension times the area of the cluster, and this is the difference between the chemical potentials between the liquid and the vapor phase times the number of molecules. Okay?
So what happened to that first term?
To what?
The P minus P.
This one. This one, it was taken by this expression here. Okay? So basically, what is important to notice is when you do the thermodynamics right, what you get here is the difference in chemical potential between the liquid of the vapor, but the chemical potential of the liquid is evaluated at the pressure of the liquid, and the chemical potential of the vapor is evaluated at the pressure of the vapor. If your drop is incompressible, you can relate the chemical potential at this pressure with the chemical potential of the vapor pressure, and the difference is these two. So if you plug it in here, you get rid of this term and you get this simplified equation. The difference between this and this is that now the chemical potential of the liquid is evaluated at the pressure of the vapor. Mm-hmm. It's a subtle thermodynamic difference, but it's the right way of doing it. Usually it doesn't make a lot of difference because this term is very small and most of the people just get rid of it. Because cluster is very small, the pressure volume work that you do to make room for this cluster in a vapor is not very large. Is most of the people just take it off and you are stick with that. Okay?
So why should the pressure of the liquid not be the same as the pressure of the vapor to start with? They're an equilibrium, right?
Yeah, but there is a difference between the two and this is the Laplace relation. So probably I shouldn't have skipped that. Okay, so if you have a cluster which is in mechanical equilibrium with a liquid phase, what you have is that the difference between the pressure inside your liquid minus the pressure in the vapor phase is just 2 times surface tension divided by the radius. So this is the Laplace equation, and it's telling you that even at equilibrium, the pressure of a liquid drop is different from the pressure of the external vapor phase. Mm-hmm. So this is where this subtle thing comes out.
I'm confused on something. This one you're doing at constant pressure?
I'm doing this at constant pressure, constant total number of molecules, constant temperature.
Okay.
Uh-huh. If I will do it at...
That should be a PV as well.
Sorry?
The net pressure, or that should be the external pressure, the P in the first equation, in the boxed equation, in the red equation.
Oh, yeah, this is P... P vapor, sorry. This is the pressure of the vapor phase.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you maintain a constant pressure P, it's different from either PV or PL?
No, this P is equal to the vapor pressure because what you control in the outside is the pressure of the vapor. That's why I forgot here the V. The total pressure of your system is the vapor pressure. This is what you control. But it's different from the pressure you will have inside your liquid drop, which have this... Laplace correction. So this is the general expression for the free energy formation of a cluster in of a liquid cluster in a supersaturated vapor.
What was why you had to assume this equimolar assumption?
To get rid of the of
but
this
what
term
is the
here.
If you have that thing. If you have that NS term or mu S minus, what is that
that you have an extra variable that you don't know what is its value. Okay, so if you have these three phases, you have liquid, vapor, and something in between, which is the surface. Okay, the nice thing about this choice of the equimolar is that this choice of the dividing surface gets rid of this term here, so everything gets expressed only in terms of how many molecules you have in the liquid phase, but not on how many molecules you have in the liquid plus in the surface. This is one of possible choices of this of this dividing surface. There is another one, which is the surface of tension, that solves another set of problems, but this one is nice in that respect. It simplifies the things considerably. Mm-hmm. Okay? So, should we stop for a coffee at this point? Okay, and I will then explain you what can you do with this, how you get critical cluster sizes, and what are the nucleation rate for different examples, not only condensation, but crystallization and so on.
Okay, are there any... I would think that this NS equal to zero will not be like a very good assumption, right? Because you can say that if your cluster is very large, then you can sort of neglect the number of atoms at the surface. But...
No, this is just coming from this particularly wise choice of the dividing surface. So this dividing surface, so what you consider the liquid and what you consider the vapor depends on where you place this sharp interface between the two, right? So I can move this in principle.
Okay.
And if I move this, what will happen is that all the properties of my system will depend on where I place the interface.
Okay.
Okay, so... In particular, I can place it in such a way so that the excess of molecules I have here from the sharp profile I'm assuming and the real profile of the cluster and the excess of molecule, this area here, from the vapor phase, they are the same. If these two areas are the same, it means that the total number of molecules in the system is number of liquid molecules plus number of vapor molecules, so there is nothing left for the interface. The nice thing about that is that if there are no molecules in the interface, it does not contribute to the work of formation, and you have simplified tremendously the problem.
Just like in the chemical reaction rates, the rate does not depend upon exactly the very place in the phase. Here also it will not matter where the ultimate answer will not depend upon
that. So the particular values of all the quantities that you have, like the energy of the liquid phase or the vapor phase, depend on where you place this interface. But as he is saying, the final result, the rate of formation and the work of formation of this cluster does not depend on where you place it. So you play with this degree of freedom and you place it in a part where you solve your problems, basically.